Louis Mountbatten, the respected war hero, brutally murdered by the IRA in 1979.
Like all tragic deaths, it does add to the enigma, the charisma, the status of the man.
But does his public image reflect the man he really was? Known for his military might during World War II, he made some disastrous mistakes that cost the lives of his men.
Mountbatten was arrogant. He often thought he knew best.
As Viceroy of India, he was in charge of independence. But was he to blame for the resulting bloodshed?
There again, you have Mountbatten being rather reckless, but this time with the lives of a subcontinent.
A self-appointed advisor to Prince Philip, Prince Charles, and the Queen, he penetrated the heart of the royal family.
You could never underestimate Mountbatten's influence on anything to do with the royal family at that time.
He was very impressive and he was a bully. You know, he was very good at getting his own way.
But his carefully created public image hid a scandalous marriage and sexual exploits.
Was he bisexual? Probably, as a young man. A lot of young men are.
What was the driving force behind this vain, ruthless leader who defined an age, an empire, and the British monarchy?
His main aim was self-promotion. He wanted to maximize the publicity for himself at whatever cost.
This is the story of the man behind the propaganda.
I'm the most controversial man that you could possibly imagine.
Tonight, we reveal the truth about the man so long celebrated as a great hero.
He was no saint. Clearly, there are still controversies about whether he deserves the credit that he certainly took for himself.
Was Lord Mountbatten a hero or villain? August 1979. Lord Mountbatten is enjoying his annual summer holiday with his family at Classybourne Castle on the northwest coast of Ireland.
Mountbatten loved the outdoors, and being on his estate, he could indulge in being Lord of the Manor and having his family all around him.
Fairly simple life. They had a fishing boat, the Shadow Five. They liked to go out lobster potting. He was a popular figure in the local area.
On the 27th of August, Mountbatten takes his family out on the Shadow Five to lift lobster pots. With him are his twin grandsons, Nicholas and Timothy, daughter Patricia and her husband John, John's mother, Lady Doreen Brayborn, and a local boy, Paul Maxwell, who helped out with the boat.
They were completely unaware that there was 50 pounds of explosives strapped to the bottom of the boat.
And as they went to lift the lobster pots, 11:45, a bomb was detonated from a hilltop or clifftop nearby, and they were all blown up.
The bomb seems to have gone off right where Mountbatten was on the boat. And the boat was simply destroyed. Mountbatten was killed instantly.
The shattered and splintered woodwork is mute testament to the severity of the bomb blast.
This is all that remains of Earl Mountbatten's 28-foot boat, Shadow Five.
Mountbatten's grandson, Nicholas, local teenage boatman, Paul Maxwell, and Lady Doreen Brayborn are also killed. The others are injured, but survive. The murder of this well-known royal figure is so significant that the BBC interrupts its programming to deliver the news to the nation.
Earl Mountbatten of Burma has been killed in an explosion on his boat off the west coast of Ireland. The provisional IRA have said that they were responsible.
In terms of the IRA making a statement that this was war, there was no doubt about it. They were killing a very senior and revered member of the royal family. It was a devastating blow, which had really gone to the heart of the British establishment.
In death, Mountbatten is celebrated as an elder statesman and legendary war hero.
Britain likes heroes, Britain likes the monarchy, and I think that accounts for a lot of the legendary status of Mountbatten.
He was thought definitely to be a great Briton, and I think the British public was shocked, there's no doubt about it.
Thousands of people lined the streets of London for his funeral procession, ahead of the service at Westminster Abbey. As a man who spent his lifetime controlling his public image, in true Mountbatten style, he'd also organized his own farewell.
Mountbatten spent years planning his own funeral with military precision. He was aware that the eyes of the world would be upon him and on the occasion, and he wasn't wrong.
I think even his closest friend would say was an extremely vain man, very interested in decorations and in pomp and ceremony, so he would have loved his funeral.
The funeral marked the end of one of the most extraordinary lives of the 20th century. This is a story about one man who created the myth of himself as a hero and worked his way into the heart of the British establishment.
Geoffrey Golden and I are going to put the questions many viewers must be asking to you, Lord Mountbatten, and to your colleagues in the making of the series, Peter Morley and...
In this extract from a 1969 interview with Eamon Andrews about his series, The Life and Times of Lord Mountbatten, Mountbatten hints that there is more to him than the public might think, even after his life had been examined through 12 hours of television documentary.
And you're not really a controversial man. Why not?
I'm the most controversial man that you could possibly imagine. When history is written, I suppose after I'm dead, somebody will get at all these papers I've kept at home and write it. They'll find I was pretty controversial.
I think he enjoyed being complex and suggesting he had depths to his personality that many people would have questioned he had.
He was a man to whom our nation could look, to recall and inspire its spirit of action and its reverence of personal courage.
Now looking back on his life, who really was this aristocrat and self-confessed snob? Mountbatten was born in 1900, at the beginning of a century where Britain underwent massive change. The son of German Prince Louis of Battenberg and Princess Victoria of Hesse, and a great-grandson of Queen Victoria, they lived in Britain as members of the extended royal family. One of four children, Mountbatten, known as Dickie, was the youngest by 8 years.
He was very much a sort of afterthought and brought up really as an only child. The fact that he was the youngest meant that he was someone who was used to getting his own way and slightly spoilt.
This was probably the formation of what I call his huge character. You know, he wanted to be noticed, he wanted to be loved, and he made sure he was from a very young age.
Despite his cosseted childhood, Mountbatten was expected to follow in the footsteps of his father, who held the prestigious title a First Sea Lord in charge of the Royal Navy. At the age of 13, Mountbatten was sent off to Naval College.
He's, I think, 48th in line to the throne when he's born. So as a young man, he's got to make his own way in the world.
It was a pretty harsh discipline. He was good looking, and they teased him because of his background.
It wasn't somewhere for a sensitive boy. But lucky Louis at this age was probably not particularly sensitive, and the life suited him.
As Mountbatten was getting his first taste of Navy life, World War I broke out. Suddenly, his family's strong German roots and the name Battenberg became a big problem.
There was a huge wave of anti-German sentiment sweeping the country to the extent that even Dachshunds were shunned, and anyone with a German name was going to feel a good deal of hostility. In Mountbatten's case, because at that stage he was still Louis Battenberg, it came in the form of vitriolic comments while at Naval College. He was called a Hun, he was called a spy.
The anti-German backlash led to a pivotal moment for young Louis when it ended his father's career.
Prince Louis of Battenberg had served with total loyalty in Queen Victoria's navy. And when the First World War broke out, there was a campaign against him, and so he had to resign.
I think he fully expected Winston Churchill would reject that offer to resign, but in fact, Churchill did nothing of the kind.
The fact that the father was forced out as First Sea Lord was an occasion of great shame and embarrassment. Very, very tough if you were a naval cadet at the time to have your father go from top of the tree to completely out and disgraced.
Mountbatten decided that he was going to avenge it by rising to the same position as his father had had and being First Sea Lord.
As the situation in Britain worsened, King George V realized that he needed to protect the monarchy by distancing his family from its very German background. In a radical move, he changed the family name from Saxe-Coburg and Gotha to Windsor in 1917. All of his relatives, including Mountbatten's father, Prince Louis of Battenberg, were forced to renounce their titles and change their names to something that sounded a little more British.
Berg in German is mountain. So it was Batten Mountain, if you like, and he thought about maybe Mount Batten instead of Batten Mountain. So it became Mountbatten.
Not only had Mountbatten's father lost his job, but they had now lost their family name too.
I think it made him more determined to prove how loyal and how British he was.
I think Louis wanted to get the honour of his family back, I'm absolutely certain of that, and to make the name of Mountbatten, a new name, a famous name.
Mountbatten's time at Naval College was cut short by the war. Instead, at the age of just 16, he was dispatched to serve aboard HMS Lion.
One of their tasks was to protect the city of Sunderland, which was coming under shell attack from the sea from German cruisers. This was the start of his great naval career in many ways.
When the war finally ended, Mountbatten spent two terms at Cambridge. Alongside his studies, he made friends in very high places.
He became very friendly with his cousins, Bertie and Henry, two of the sons of George V. And through them, he became very close to the Prince of Wales, the future King Edward VIII.
He was aware of being related to all the crowned heads of Europe, but he would also have been aware that he was a very long way from being a crowned head.
Mountbatten's close relationship with the King's sons paid dividends. In 1920, the Prince of Wales invited him on a royal tour to Australia and New Zealand.
Mountbatten sort of clawed his way onto the renown. You know, he needed the Prince of Wales very much. I mean, otherwise, what would he be doing? He'd be sort of serving somewhere in the Navy, perhaps not doing anything particularly interesting.
They became friends for life, and that's really significant for Mountbatten because he comes to regard himself as equal to the Prince of Wales.
From a young age, Mountbatten's ambition was clear. Cozying up to senior royals would only help in his quest to bring honour back to his family name and avenge his father's departure as head of the Navy. But his aspirations were very nearly derailed by his marriage and the dysfunctional and scandalous private lives led by him and his wife.
Mountbatten knew divorce would damage his career prospects, his reputation, and of course his closeness to the royal family.
By the early 1920s, Mountbatten's career was flourishing, but the same couldn't be said for his love life. When he met wealthy socialite Edwina Ashley, a relationship blossomed. Her impact on his life and public image would be seismic.
Mountbatten fell passionately in love with Edwina. She was very beautiful, she was very rich, she was very eligible, and she was terrific fun.
I think it was an instant attraction. They were both good looking, they were both young. He was a great romantic, he was always falling in love with girls and always then being rejected by them.
The young couple, Mountbatten aged 22 and Edwina just 21, married on the 18th of July 1922. His wedding gave Mountbatten his first taste of planning signature events with all the pomp and splendor he reveled in.
The wedding of Edwina Ashley and Lord Louis Mountbatten was undoubtedly the society wedding of the year. It took place in St. Margaret's, Westminster, which is a very beautiful medieval church, literally next door to Westminster Abbey.
Something like 8,000 people came to see them get married. The king and queen were among the guests.
It was certainly a very good match, and it was a very fashionable wedding, and with the Prince of Wales as best man, you couldn't get much higher than that.
And it wasn't just a wife Mountbatten gained when he married Edwina, who inherited over £2 million on her wedding day.
Mountbatten didn't have any money at all when he married her, and all the money came from her. So it was a very prestigious marriage for him.
With his royal lineage and Edwina's fortune, Lord and Lady Mountbatten became a glamorous power couple. Their lavish honeymoon had all the hallmarks of a royal tour.
This is the beginning of the Roaring Twenties, at least it is for the aristocracy. So they went round Europe within the Rolls Royce that she had given him as a present.
The second part of the honeymoon, they went to the States and they met people like Babe Ruth, the baseball player.
They ended up in Hollywood, entertained by no less than Charlie Chaplin, who was the most famous comic star of the era.
When the honeymoon was over, Mountbatten returned to his beloved Navy, leaving his new wife at home.
The Navy meant everything to him. Yes, he adored his wife, he worshipped her, in fact. But the Navy seemed to come first, and Edwina felt neglected.
When Mountbatten returned to the Navy, Edwina kind of forgot about him, really, and just carried on life as if she was a single lady.
Mountbatten had no idea just how unhappy his wife was until he heard unsettling stories about her behaviour from the Prince of Wales.
By 1925, there were problems in the marriage. She just didn't want to be just a socialite and running a home. And she began to have affairs. And this upset Dickie enormously.
The fact that she was in another man's bed, it was a slight on his ability and a slight on his manhood, which he didn't like.
The danger for them both was, of course, that the wider public would become aware of what was going on in her private life. And indeed, there were some very close scrapes. She was named in a divorce action. The wife who had named Edwina as her husband's mistress was paid off, and the whole business was covered up.
Even in his 20s, Mountbatten was very aware of his public persona and did everything he could to protect it. Despite having two young daughters, Edwina did not step back from her outrageous behavior. Mountbatten decided on a highly unusual arrangement to keep her happy and save face. An open marriage.
Mountbatten knew divorce would damage his career prospects, his reputation, and of course his closeness to the royal family.
He didn't want to be embarrassed by her behaviour, and he didn't want the royal family to be embarrassed by her behaviour. So he said, well, if this is going to happen, you have to be discreet about it.
So they continued to be, if you like, you know, this favoured couple who got invited to all the best parties, but they were living very separate lives.
Behind closed doors, Edwina carried on with her lovers, who included friend Hugh Molyneux, actor Paul Robeson, and singer Leslie Hutchinson. Not wanting to be left out, Mountbatten started to have some fun of his own.
Mountbatten seems to have had a long-term relationship with Yola Lotelier, who's a young French woman.
Mountbatten liked looking at beautiful things, and his girlfriends were always very good looking. And in fact, Edwina got quite jealous.
He had charm, so the ladies loved him. He had everything. He had panache, a certain je ne sais quoi, the French might say.
When Mountbatten said that he and Edwina spent their entire lives getting into other people's beds, it was a joke, but he meant it. They did.
Although they were able to keep their scandalous marriage hidden from the public, a recently discovered FBI file from the 1940s details explosive claims made by socialite Lady Elizabeth Desaize to a special agent. She told the FBI that in royal circles, Edwina and Mountbatten were considered to be people of extremely low morals. She also suggested that Mountbatten was actually homosexual.
Mountbatten's chauffeur in 1948 had a story about being told that when Mountbatten came, he should be aware of where the male brothel in Malta was, because Mountbatten would want to go there.
Homosexual tendencies among the British upper classes were not exactly a secret, but they were hugely frowned upon, and they would have brought disgrace to the family name.
It was extraordinarily indiscreet, because it was a criminal offence until the 1960s. Even until the beginning of the century, people were thrown out of the armed forces if they were found to be homosexual. And what was so extraordinary is so many people seemed to know about it and just cover it up.
He and Edwina looked to me as typical aristocratic, free-loving people who figured that the normal rules and moral regulations of society didn't necessarily have to apply to them.
If he was a young man now, he would just come out and say, I am bisexual, but then he couldn't do that.
As Mountbatten and Edwina negotiated their unconventional marriage, his cousin and close friend, the Prince of Wales, became King Edward VIII. But the new king didn't last for long. He caused a constitutional crisis when he chose to abdicate the throne to marry his divorced lover, Wallis Simpson. Mountbatten's own complicated private life paled in comparison. He was frustrated by the king's obsession with Wallis.
Mountbatten certainly told the king that he should at least delay, keep her as a mistress, that, you know, his responsibilities as king meant that he, you know, really couldn't marry her.
This advice was likely motivated in part by Mountbatten's desire to hold on to his powerful position as one of the king's trusted allies. The great friendship he'd spent years engineering with the future monarch was suddenly worthless. Mountbatten quickly shifted his allegiance to the new king, George VI.
Mountbatten always wanted to be on the winning side, make no mistake about that. And the king is dead, long live the king. I mean, he was going to cement himself to the new monarch.
As King George VI took the throne, unrest was brewing in Europe. World War II gave Mountbatten the opportunity to rise through the ranks of the Navy and create an enduring image of himself as a great British war hero. But behind the facade lurked a brutal and often careless leader.
He could organize his men, but he also made some horrendous mistakes.
He did what suited him, often at the cost of other people's lives.
The Second World War gave Mountbatten the opportunity to further cultivate his own legend, skillfully navigating his stellar rise, but he was to be responsible for some spectacular errors. However, his friends in high places ensured that he'd be given every opportunity to have an impact in the conflict.
It was Churchill who could see that Mountbatten had star qualities, and at a time when people needed to think outside the box, in which one needed these inspirational figures with great powers of leadership, Mountbatten fitted the bill.
Churchill also felt he owed Mountbatten a debt after his father was forced to resign as First Sea Lord 20 years earlier.
He was driven by a sense of guilt that he had not behaved well towards Dickie's father, and that he would make amends by helping the son.
He had enormous self-confidence. He could organize his men. He could ensure that they followed him into battle. He could enthuse them, and he never gave up. But he also made some horrendous mistakes.
In October 1939, while in command of HMS Kelly, Mountbatten was given orders to engage with a German battleship and rescue several hundred British seamen.
Instead of making the sort of obvious route that he was told to make by his navigation officers, he decided to do things a different way. He always liked doing shortcuts and was impatient, and the result was that he missed the battleship, and he also failed to rescue 600 seamen. As a result, they spent the war in the prisoner of war camp. Mountbatten was arrogant. He often thought he knew best. He did what suited him. But the result was that often at the cost of other people's lives.
It was to set the tone for Mountbatten's command.
The first voyages of the Kelly are really a chapter of accidents, things that go wrong. He collides with a ship in the harbour. Another time he turns too fast and a torpedo hits the ship and men are lost.
He would lose seamen off the side of the boat by going too fast and having waves come up the side.
During his command of the Kelly, he lost more than 150 men.
You know, he was a disaster, and there were demands for him to be court-martialed because of his cavalier behaviour.
But his position at the heart of the establishment allowed him to deflect blame for his inadequacies as a commander.
He deployed Edwina to charm the people in the Admiralty and King George VI and various other people. So instead of being court-martialed, he actually got the DSO, which of course he'd lobbied for as well. He was shameless, really, in his ambition and his ruthlessness, and he was very effective.
At Buckingham Palace, devotion to duty met with its reward when over 200 decorations were presented at a recent investiture. Captain Lord Louis Mountbatten was accompanied by his wife as he left the palace.
His mistakes weren't just covered up. His friends in the world of show business mythologized his war disasters as heroics.
His reputation was enhanced, particularly by a film which became an Academy Award winner and one of the most popular films of the year, In Which We Serve, made by his friend Noel Coward.
Well done. We've got him, but I'm afraid he's got us too.
It was based entirely on Mountbatten and his maritime service on HMS Kelly. And it was a huge success and propelled Mountbatten into the realms of superhero.
What sort of a ship do I want the Torin to be?
A happy ship, sir.
That's right.
An efficient ship, sir.
Correct. A happy and efficient ship. A very happy and a very efficient ship. Some of you might think I'm a bit ambitious wanting both, but in my experience, you can't have one without the other.
It's a great piece of propaganda. It becomes a story of British pluck and British character and of the imperious but charming aristocrat Kinross, based on Mountbatten, working with the lads, working with his crew, one of whom is Richard Attenborough in his very, very first part.
In Which We Serve enhanced Mountbatten's perception amongst the public cinema goers who thought he was wonderful and a hero. It greatly damaged Mountbatten's standing and prestige amongst his fellow officers and the political elite in Britain, who were horrified that a story of such tragic consequences should be glorified as this wonderful episode of the Second World War. Mountbatten was able to bounce back from some of these mistakes, never held to account for the tragedies that followed in their wake.
In 1941, believing that he was too reckless to command a battleship, Churchill moved Mountbatten to a prestigious military desk job.
The King's cousin has been appointed Chief of Combined Operations with the acting rank of Vice Admiral.
one of the reasons that Churchill promoted him to Chief of Combined Operations was the feeling in the Admiralty that Dickie should never be given command of another ship after Kelly. He was not at his best at sea. He was much better as an operator behind the scenes, even later in his career, really ever a serving naval officer. He was always a staff officer.
Although no longer leading from the front, once again his command would be called into question. On August the 19th, 1942, he gave the order to raid Dieppe, using mainly Canadian troops stationed in Britain.
In the early morning, smoke lay thick on the sea near the beaches. Destroyers and smaller warships were laying screens behind which more craft could approach to follow up the first landing.
Without air cover and poor organization, Mountbatten ignored advice that the mission was too dangerous.
Mountbatten, as Chief of Combined Operations, wanted to raid the port and then use that as a route through to an assault inland. But poor planning, poor intelligence, meant that the Germans were well prepared and ready.
By sheer guts, Canadians and commandos cracked up those impregnable defences and stayed ashore, destroying and killing for 9 hours.
More than 900 Canadians lost their lives, and almost 2,500 were captured.
The way in which that operation seemed to be bungled very quickly became a sign of Mountbatten's poor leadership.
Despite the mission's failure and the appalling loss of life, Mountbatten later claimed that it was a useful learning curve for the successful D-Day landings.
He was very good at trying to shift the blame afterwards. He always claimed that it was a good run for D-Day, that lessons learnt there saved lives later. He was very good at twisting things to sort of make them appear better than they were.
He had this uncanny ability of turning it round. So A, it didn't look like his fault, and B, it looked exactly as if he'd done the right thing, and it was a success, not a disaster. Very clever. And he did that with a lot of things in his life.
Mountbatten was dubbed the Master of Disaster by some in the Admiralty, but his continued royal patronage and government support helped him secure yet another prestigious role, this time as Supreme Allied Commander in Southeast Asia.
He was still very young at that stage to have that kind of position. He vaulted over many generals and admirals who were far more experienced than him, but he had the backing of the Prime Minister and, of course, the tireless support of the King. And they were pivotal in smoothing the path for Dickie's various promotions.
Far away from the main theatre of war, Mountbatten found his aristocratic charm a useful substitute for his lack of military guile.
He made the most of it, even though he was denied resources, because it was very much seen as a sideshow. And morale was low amongst the 14th Army, and he went out there and restored it. He brought out doctors and nurses and managed to cut the incidences of malaria. He improved morale by arranging for them to have more letters home and a radio station and newspaper. So he was a pretty inspired appointment in many ways.
The recapture of Burma from the Japanese yet again enhanced Mountbatten's reputation, despite it being a joint operation with the Americans.
Throughout this time, he had to work really closely with his American allies. You wouldn't believe that if you saw some of the newsreel footage where it was all about Mountbatten.
He did take the responsibility for liberating Burma from the Japanese and took the title of Earl Mountbatten of Burma. Now that in a way sums up the vanity of the man, that he had to take a whole country as the other half of his peerage. Not Lord Mountbatten of South Kensington, but Lord Mountbatten of Burma.
With the eyes of the world upon him, Mountbatten is centre stage at the ceremony in Singapore on the 12th of September 1945, which officially ended the Japanese occupation of Southeast Asia. Despite a dubious war record, the image helped cement his reputation as a conquering hero.
I have come here today to receive the formal surrender of all the Japanese forces within the Southeast Asia Command.
I think he had a lot of heroic qualities, but unfortunately, there were also occasions when he miscalculated the impact of his actions. Some of his mistakes had enormously huge and tragic consequences.
He pursued his ambition greedily and hungrily, if you like. He was determined to reach the very top. And war was perfect for a man of his vanity and ambitions.
I wish you all to know the gratitude and the pride that I feel towards every man and woman in this command today. You beat the Japanese soldier in battle, inflicting 6 times the number of deaths that he was able to inflict on you, and you chased him out of Burma.
He was very conscious of the power of public relations and how it could project his success and help him in his career.
The public wanted a hero, and Mountbatten fitted the bill very nicely. Even though he was responsible for disasters, he came out smelling of roses, and everybody needs a war hero, and the British government were keen to promote him as a hero, you know, in very difficult times.
Mountbatten's perceived reputation as a great hero helped secure his next appointment, the last Viceroy of India. Just as in the war, he was to bring a brand of reckless impatience to a situation that called for anything but, with dire consequences.
Millions of people were uprooted on either side. So that is a huge legacy of bitterness and bloodshed.
Twice Lord Louis Mountbatten brought his ship home, though crippled in battles against heavy odds. And he has won the DSO for his gallantry.
Bestowed with medals from his war exploits, Mountbatten's next role is to be the greatest challenge of his career, as he is appointed the last Viceroy of India in 1947. And once more, he has a helping hand from the King and his government connections.
He was very much riding high in that sense, you know, with his links with the royal family, with his links with the Labour establishment, who saw him as the ideal figure.
Far from covering himself with glory, Mountbatten's actions in extracting Britain from India were to leave a devastating legacy.
It was a volatile situation. There had already been numerous massacres between the Hindus and the Muslims. Independence had been promised, and the people were now clamoring for change. A man of action was needed, somebody who could extricate Britain from a situation that was becoming increasingly unstable.
Mountbatten faced a Muslim minority led by Muhammad Ali Jinnah, who wanted to separate themselves from the dominant Hindu majority led by Jawaharlal Nehru. But he was not sent to partition India. Rather, the British government wanted the country to remain united.
The hope is that all the constituent parts of India, all the different ethnic and religious groups, will live in one dominion, like Canada or some other part of the Commonwealth.
Never one to miss an occasion for a PR moment, the pomp and ceremony of his investiture is beamed around the world.
Lord and Lady Mountbatten have taken their places on the thrones for the swearing-in ceremony of the new Viceroy.
It's about building an image of a glorious end to a glorious empire. That is what the British public wanted to see. That is what the government wanted to achieve. But it was all smoke and mirrors.
While Mountbatten basks briefly in the imperial glory of his new post, outside the confines of Viceroy House, the country is in turmoil.
There is so much communal violence going on in northern India, in Calcutta, in the Punjab, which means that some kind of solution has to emerge very quickly.
The government gives him a year to oversee independence, so talks were to begin immediately. But while Mountbatten was famed for his charm, much more would be needed to navigate such choppy waters.
He had no knowledge of India. He was parachuted in. I mean, someone like Wavell, his predecessor, had served as commander-in-chief. He had commanded troops. He had lived with Indian soldiers in the field. He spoke Indian languages. Mountbatten had none of these qualifications.
To negotiate independence, Mountbatten needed to be even-handed in his treatment of leaders on all sides, but found himself drawn to Nehru from the beginning.
I think a lot of it was to do with the fact that Mountbatten wasn't really a politician. He decided early on that Nehru, who was the leader of the Congress, was the person to back. He was westernized, Harrow and Cambridge educated. He was very much the sort of person they wanted to have dinner with. Jinnah, who led the Muslim League, was much less sympathetic to them. They just didn't get on with him.
It wasn't just Mountbatten's relationship with Nehru that compromised his impartiality. It was also his wife's.
Edwina seems to have fallen genuinely in love with Jawaharlal Nehru, and it was a relationship that seems to have been genuinely romantic and probably sexual. Her influence on Nehru and his influence on Mountbatten through her was fairly decisive in some respects. There was even gossip that there were threesomes going on. So there were bizarre leaflets being circulated suggesting that Mountbatten was in bed, literally, with both Edwina and Jawaharlal Nehru.
As eyebrows are raised, talks become ever more antagonistic. Increasingly fearful of a future for Muslims in a united India, Jinnah's demands for the creation of a separate state grow louder.
Mountbatten comes to the conclusion that the only acceptable solution to all sides in this drama would be independence but with partition. So the creation of two separate states.
I don't think Jinnah, who was the person who demanded Pakistan, ever expected to get it. It was a bargaining counter so that he could get the Muslims guaranteed quotas, protection, and giving them autonomy in the provinces where they were in a majority.
Less than 3 months in India, Mountbatten decides it is to be carved up along religious lines, creating a new nation, Pakistan. In a radio broadcast, he explained his decision as something that was unavoidable.
There can be no question of coercing any large areas in which one community has a majority to live against their will under a government in which another community has a majority. And the only alternative to coercion is partition.
Partition wasn't inevitable, in my opinion. Nothing in history is actually inevitable. I think people's actions cause things to happen, and unintended consequences often follow.
Perhaps he should and could have taken longer to try and convince some of the Indians, including Jinnah, to sit around the table and accept a different solution. But I think it would be extremely difficult eventually to persuade all the parties to accept a form of independence without separation.
As well as rushing the decision to partition the country, Mountbatten also hurries everything that follows, blindsiding everyone with an announcement of the date of independence.
With Mountbatten's flair for the dramatic, he called a major press conference on the 3rd of June, and in front of 300 journalists, when asked, "So when will India be independent?" he just announced the 15th of August, which was only a few months away.
It could equally well have been June 1948, which was what the deadline that Attlee had given him. So bringing it forward to the 15th of August 1947 was a completely random decision, A, to pick a date that suited him, and B, to show how efficient he'd been.
India was to be divided, and the new nation of Pakistan was to be created in just 72 days.
Mountbatten has been rightly criticized for this unilateral speed with which independence and the date was selected. It didn't make much sense, except perhaps to someone who was in a hurry. And there again, you have Mountbatten being rather reckless, but this time with the lives of a subcontinent.
Despite the obvious complexity of partition, maps are drawn up in just 5 weeks.
It's incredibly complicated. I mean, how are you going to draw up the borders? What about the rivers and the natural borders, the mountains, the irrigation systems? Wouldn't they favor one side over the other? And Mountbatten drafted in experts from Britain to sort of redraw the map of India, but it was a bit of a dog's dinner.
And Mountbatten had another trick up his sleeve. Knowing the new borders would cause chaos, he insisted the Independence Day celebrations took place before they were revealed.
So with Independence Day, driving in state with Jawaharlal Nehru by his side, showing that it was a peaceful transition, he didn't want it to be marred by arguments about the boundaries and people being fed up with the outcome of those. So the idea was to push as many things under the carpet as could be done until they actually had to be faced.
2 days later, when the borders were revealed, panic set in and the full horror of partition was unleashed. In the ensuing weeks, 1 million people lost their lives and 15 million were displaced as people fled to cross the new borders.
The charge sheet against Mountbatten is quite long. Historians of the British Commonwealth, historians of India and Pakistan do see him to blame for the rushed way in which partition of India took place in the summer of 1947, the consequences of which, the separation of the Hindu and Muslim parts, led to hundreds of thousands of deaths. Whilst no one has said this equates to war crimes, it is certainly a very black mark on his record.
Churchill, seeing his beloved India torn apart in such a violent and chaotic way, held his protege to account.
Churchill was appalled by what happened with partition, and when they met, Churchill confronted Mountbatten and said he considered what he had done to India was the equivalent of being struck across the face with a riding crop, and he had been shocked by what he had done, and the relationship between the two men ceased from that point for several years, and Churchill would have nothing more to do with him.
And 70 years later, Churchill's predictions for an India and Pakistan that would remain riven with conflict is a tragic testament to Mountbatten's withdrawal.
Partition left a very deep wound. You know, families who lost loved ones in the transfer of populations, who lost their homes, their wealth, their possessions. Millions of people were uprooted on either side. So that is a huge legacy of bitterness and bloodshed.
By the late 1940s, Mountbatten had a seriously checkered past, both personally and professionally. Can he inveigle his way into a new generation of the royal family, regardless? And will he achieve his lifetime ambition and avenge his father against the odds?
He was very impressive and he was a bully, so he was very good at getting his own way.
Despite the war raging between the newly minted Pakistan and India, Mountbatten and Edwina returned to the UK as though independence and partition were a huge success.
Our thoughts and our best wishes and our warm affection will remain with our many friends in India, always.
They touched down to much fanfare and a royal welcome from his nephew, Prince Philip.
Mountbatten was very keen on promoting his image, using the media as much as possible. He was a very good-looking man, he had a very beautiful wife, and they were a very decorative couple.
Mountbatten had a new opportunity to place himself at the centre of power and influence. Just 7 months earlier, his nephew married Princess Elizabeth, the woman who would be queen.
His influence was key in bringing Prince Philip into the royal family and then helping to shape that post-war image of the royal family as dutiful, where the greater good was put first.
Philip's marriage to Princess Elizabeth was the culmination of more than a decade of Mountbatten manoeuvres. And the couple spent their wedding night at Edwina's family pile, Broadlands. He may have finally made his way to the top table, but he wasn't seen as a force for good by everyone in the royal family.
They were scandalised by Edwina's private life.
Philip was very down on Edwina. I think he didn't like the idea of his uncle being cuckolded by this woman.
It wasn't just Edwina who was disapproved of. There was one royal who didn't like Mountbatten either.
The Queen Mother, you see, was somebody that would very quietly be able to get her own way on things and see him as somebody who was always scheming, if you like. She was in a much more powerful position. It was very difficult for him to get past her.
The Queen Mother, as far as Mountbatten was concerned, I mean, she did everything to keep him out. He wanted the friendship with the Queen.
Fortunately for Mountbatten, Princess Elizabeth wasn't as suspicious of her husband's favourite uncle as her mother had been.
I think it irritated the Queen Mother, but it irritated the Queen far less. It was Philip that sort of got irritated by his interfering and said, you know, I can do this on my own, you know. I don't need you to interfere in everything, and I don't need you to interfere in my marriage.
In his professional life, there were no such snobs. The 1950s saw his return to Malta, quickly followed by the appointment he'd been waiting for his whole life. He was made First Sea Lord, laying to rest the slur against his family.
He had never forgotten the family humiliation and pain suffered by his father when he had been forced to resign in 1914. So this, for Mountbatten, was a glorious chapter, the high point of his career, both professionally, but also personally.
He spent 4 years in the job he loved before again being promoted. But becoming the Chief of Defence Staff was a bittersweet appointment.
James, it's a very sad day when you leave your own particular profession. Because in the Ministry of Defence, I'm once more back to an entirely inter-service job.
There were big changes looming in his personal life, too. His younger daughter had just got married. But the celebrations are to be short-lived.
The deepest sympathy is expressed to Lord Mountbatten on the death of his wife.
It was a big shock for everybody. She hadn't been well, but I don't think anyone was expecting her to die. She was only 59. She was buried at sea. Queen Mother apparently said, so like Edwina, she always did everything with a splash.
Mountbatten was obviously devastated. He had often spoken about how, over the years, they had become closer.
Eventually, Mountbatten resumed his social life and, as a single man, had many different companions.
He was much taken with Shirley MacLaine, the Hollywood actress, who became a companion for a while.
I used to see quite a lot of women going in and out of his house when I was walking the dog. He was off to cocktails or the yacht club. Were they companions for fun? Certainly was in need of female company because he was missing his wife.
There was never anyone formal in his life. He had various affairs of the heart. Whether they were physical or not, no one's entirely sure.
It's at this point in his life that Mountbatten formed perhaps his most influential friendship with a member of the royal family. Great-nephew Prince Charles, heir to the throne.
There's no denying the mutual affection and love. And Charles looked on Mountbatten, dare I say it, for the affirmation, for the confidence, for the backing that he perhaps didn't get.
Well, I'm sure that as far as Prince Charles was concerned, the legendary Mountbatten charm was turned on full blast.
Although there may have been an ulterior motive to begin with, it grew into something you can't buy. It was called love.
And Mountbatten was determined that Charles should have lots of sexual experiences before marriage. We know from his letters that this was something he regretted about his own life.
He insisted that Charles should sow his wild oats and took a leading role in introducing Charles to eligible, young, beautiful women.
One of the things that Mountbatten said, which maybe wasn't such a great idea, was that Prince Charles simply had to marry a virgin. He disapproved very much of Camilla Shand. He said to Charles, you know, have fun with her, have a good time with her, but you can't marry her because, you know, she's got a past. And Charles paid heed to what he said.
Whatever his intentions and the psychology driving them, there's no denying that Mountbatten shaped the modern royal family for good and ill.
Well, you could never underestimate Mountbatten's influence on anything to do with the royal family. I think he instilled that kind of service ideal in them, and everyone wanted to serve the monarch.
He was very impressive, and he was a bully, you know, and so he was very good at getting his own way. He was always getting involved and trying to marry them off to one another. You know, he never stopped, really.
As his machinations continued into his later life, Mountbatten's hold over the royal family remained strong. But scandal was never far away. This time, a plot to unseat the Prime Minister. Will his legacy be what he would have hoped for? Or will skeletons threaten his status?
I still miss Mountbatten. I miss that positive energy. It doesn't exist in people these days.
I think he would have loved the publicity and the attention and this idea of dying a hero.
Throughout his life, Mountbatten chased positions of power and influence and constantly fought for the spotlight.
He loved power, and he knew where power lay. He just liked to create these empires separately, often from the existing structures, because, of course, that gave him his power base.
Time of the Silver Jubilee, he talks about his reluctance to come out onto the balcony with the Queen and Prince Philip. Of course, he wasn't reluctant. You know, he was dying to get out there.
The banners they carried announced their four main demands.
By the late 1960s, he was a retiree who looked out of step with society and the changing times.
The last of Queen Victoria's great-grandchildren born during her lifetime. Someone with dashing Hollywood-style looks, but of the 1920s.
He was no longer as famous as he had been as Chief of the Defence Staff.
Mountbatten came up with a solution to this. A landmark series for primetime national television, all about Mountbatten.
This is the first of a series of television programmes about my life.
He wanted people to like him, although he had massive self-confidence. He liked being liked.
Well, I think, you know, he was a man worried about his legacy, hence he made that 12-part series on himself.
One of the things that Mountbatten was very good at was cultivating the media and cultivating a public image.
Oh, hands to the gap. Give me that.
But Mountbatten is both subject and narrator of his own life story to show him in the most favourable light possible.
It was a classic Mountbatten exercise in PR, as Eamon Andrews identified when he interviewed the Earl at the time.
The one carping note concerns the man at the centre of it all. Can he, some critics ask, and ask again this morning, really be as perfect as all that? Did he never make a mistake?
Looking back, there are very few things I'd have done differently
myself that when I'm dead and history really dispassionately comes to be written, people may think I was wrong. All right.
Mountbatten the hero put on a royal premiere at the Imperial War Museum, and the Queen and Prince Philip were there, along with the Prime Minister, Harold Wilson. But his attendance has a hidden irony. Just that year, Mountbatten had been engaged in an audacious plot to overthrow the Prime Minister he was now glad-handing.
This was an attempt to displace Harold Wilson as the elected Prime Minister, with Mountbatten as the figurehead leader.
When Cecil King went to see him, evidently he warmed to the idea, as of course he would, because he would think he was the only person in the world who could sort anything out. I mean, he was terribly arrogant in that respect.
Mountbatten claimed he backed off when he realised it was treasonous, but not before he'd seriously entertained the idea.
It's very clear from the papers I found that he was flattered by the attention and actually had several meetings about this.
As the 60s became the 70s, the closely guarded secrets around Mountbatten's private life, his open marriage, and his sexuality were still the subject of rumor and speculation in certain circles. After his death, his personal letters revealed the truth.
He not only had a series of girlfriends, but he was bisexual.
Was he bisexual? Probably. As a young man, a lot of young men are. It's called sex.
Photographer Alan Warren was Mountbatten's friend in his later life, but many people assumed they were much more than that.
Everybody thought I was his great lover, but I treat that as a compliment, as it should be. What really made things get juicy for people with their ideas of romance or sex or whatever was that he came to me to have his naval uniform done. We then took some pictures out on the terrace, and then to get him out of the uniform, you literally need someone to tug them off, the trousers. And I had this wonderful woman that used to look after me, and she suddenly came into the bedroom with a tray of tea. And at that moment, Mountbatten was sitting on the bed with his trousers down, they were in my hands, my head was in his crutch, and she obviously thought it was more than tea going on in that room. So that compounded this thing that we were having a ringy-ding. What a lovely idea to have been Mountbatten's lover anyway. Who would say no?
There were people who I knew a lot more about his private life, but were clearly not prepared to talk about it. And I think there was a sense, even with the gay community, that that was his business and people were going to let him get on with it and not cause trouble. I think in the way that he created the legend about himself, his private life was just shut down by those around him.
Having successfully managed his own PR throughout his life, as he reached his late 70s, he turned his attention to his legacy.
He was pragmatic about death. He knew that's one thing in his entire life that he couldn't control. He kept copious letters and notes and started to really build a huge archive at Broadlands of the way he wanted to be remembered.
That goes to the heart of what made Mountbatten tick. He wasn't just content to be a big figure in his lifetime. He wanted to make sure that he had a legacy and that years after his death, when the name Mountbatten was raised, we'll go, aha, now there was a great man.
He does warn all his future biographers that there are lots of secrets you're going to find out about me. We, to this day, don't know whether all of those secrets are out there already or whether there's lots more still to come.
August 1979, and Mountbatten went on his regular family holiday to Classybourne in Ireland.
There's widespread knowledge of the family home in County Sligo, not far away from Ulster, from Belfast.
In 1979, he was expressly told not to go. The previous year, an attempt had been made by a sniper to shoot him on his boat Shadow 5. There had been various attempts to kill him.
Although he was surrounded with police, there were gaps in the security, so it was practically given to them on a plate.
His death at the hands of the IRA was an event that overtook any attempt by Mountbatten to control his own legend.
The nature of his death was so shocking to everybody that in a sense sort of turned him into even more of a hero at the time, or a victim if you like.
I think he would have loved the publicity and the attention and this idea of dying a hero.
It was an extraordinary public life that spanned much of the 20th century and was at the heart of some of its most significant events.
There were so many sides to this man, a sailor statesman who made a real impact on national and international scenes in peace and in war.
He was driven to avenge his family name, regardless of the consequences.
But above all, he was always ready to help any members of the family.
I think probably the balance would come down as hero rather than villain. You know, the war hero and friend of the royals who had this incredibly glamorous life.
It's a life historians will study for years to come.
I think he had a lot of heroic qualities, but he also made some rather large mistakes in his professional career.
He was no saint. Clearly there are still controversies about how effective he was and whether he deserves credit that he certainly took for himself.
To have a public career of such length, to keep his personal reputation largely intact, but to still leave pickings for historians 30, 40 years later. This is a man of considerable stamina and drive, and I would say achievement, though it's a flawed achievement.